Anyway, guys, thank you for setting a tone for us today to bless the name of the Lord. Thank you for coming to New Hope. If you are new, if this is your first time here, we are honored and privileged and so pleased that you would come and be with us. There are visitor cards in the pew in front of you. I would like for you to take one, fill it out, drop it in the offering bag when it comes by, and then next week through the mail, we will send you information about New Hope. We make a promise. We will not bother you on the phone or beat on your door, but through the mail, we will send you information that I hope will answer most of the questions that you have about New Hope Church. Let me highlight a few announcements and then a couple of prayer requests, and we will get re-engaged in our worship time this morning then. Next Sunday is an important Sunday for our church. Next Sunday is August the 17th, and we kick off a new 32-week series called Believe. If you've been around New Hope for a couple of years, you will remember the story. There's Believe, all right? The line underneath Believe that if you're sitting in the back, you can't read, and I'm sorry about that, but it says, living the story of the Bible to become like Jesus. And 2 years ago, we went through a study of the Bible chronologically from beginning to end, and we got a full picture of what the Bible is like in its sequential order. Starting next Sunday, we are going to go through the Bible again, but instead of it being chronologically, it is going to be theologically or thematically. We are going to look at 30 key foundational truths out of the Bible that should shape and mold our lives, and they're divided into three groups of 10. The first 10 we will look at are the key truths of the Bible, the doctrines we can build our life on. If somebody asks you the question, do you know what you believe? Could you give them a solid answer? We hope by the end of the first 10 weeks you will be able to give a solid, simple, biblical, foundational answer to what you believe. The next 10 things are the 10 practices, the key practices of the church based on the 10 doctrines. What are the 10 functions, key principles of activity of the church? And then the last 10 are the 10 key virtues of Christ that should be evident in your life and mine. They are the fruit of the Spirit with two more things tossed in, all right? And so 10, 10, and 10. If that gets a little complicated, let me give you three words. Think, act, and be. The first 10, what do you think about out of the Scriptures? The think on the doctrines of the Bible. Act, based on what you know, how does that impact the way in which you act and rehearse for life? The last 10, be. Because of what you know and what you're doing, you are becoming who God called you to be. And so that's what we're going to be looking at starting next Sunday for the next 31 to 32 weeks. If you have not purchased your Believe Bible, all right, for those of you who are strong King James folks, okay, you can still bring your King James. You can bring your regular Bible with you, all right? This one is not replacing this one. We are simply going to be using this one over the next 31 weeks. Everything that is in here is in here. It's just been rearranged according to the 30 themes. The first chapter, the first message is who is God? And so in the first chapter, it's all the verses from Genesis to Revelation that tell us who God is. All Scripture. And so we will look at that theme. So if you'd like, and this is the one I will be asking you to turn to page 419, all right, or to page 28, third paragraph. So this is what we will be using. We'll have some in the pew for visitors, but you can purchase them out there. Guys, the price is right. You get a choice, 10, 5, or free. Next year, when this is released nationwide, remember, in case you don't know, we're part of a beta church. We're a test group that's working with Randy Frazee to finalize this brainchild of his so many churches can use it across the country next year. And the books are available. If money's fine with you, $10. If money's tight with you, $5. If you're broke, they're free, all right? No questions asked. Just pick it up and take it, okay? And so we want you to bring this. Number two, I'd love for you to bring a notebook with you when you bring this starting next week. Write down the things that you want to remember so you don't forget them as we talk about God, as we talk about Jesus, as we talk about faith, as we talk about grace. Write down the things that you don't want to forget. So bring this and bring a notebook with you. And then the last challenge is a pastor. And if you're new to New Hope, you're saying, oh, he sounds like every other pastor I've ever heard. Try not to miss the next 31 weeks. We gave you this challenge of stories. You know, church attendance is not what gets you into heaven, all right? Church attendance doesn't give you any more stars in your crown. But it's kind of like when a doctor gives you a prescription and he tells you when to take it. He says, you know, take it this way so it does the best good. I'm going to tell you, taking this, seeing the way it builds, one on top of the other for these 31 consecutive weeks will be very, very important. I know you're not going to, I doubt if 10% of you will have perfect attendance the next 31 weeks. I don't. But here's the deal. Keep it limited. Number two, go to the website the following week and watch it or listen to it on the website. All right? I would recommend listening because I have a face for radio. And so if you have a choice, just listen instead of watch. But these are crucial. And as many of you said, wow, the story changed my life. Many of you said that. I never understood the Bible in that context, what a difference it made. I think this will be five times the difference in our lives as we get solid foundations on these key 30 subjects out of the Bible. So absolutely important. So that starts next Sunday. What also makes next Sunday important is Sunday night. We're meeting at 6 o'clock next Sunday night. Whether you're a member, regular attender, or first-time visitor, we'd love to have you join us for a business meeting. We're going to be talking about two things. One, launching Love Your Neighbor, all right? Just some ideas of how we take the love of Christ which is in us, not a program, not a new department at the church, but just a new mindset of how we love our neighbors and influence the community that we live in. And then, what are we going to do with the physical property here at New Hope? We've been talking about adding a building. We have some solid information to bring back to you next Sunday night and to get your input on what is the next step. What does that look like? All right? And here's what I can tell you. Again, for those of you who might be new, that does not look like big debt here. We have been debt-free for 20 of the 21 years, all right, here, and we plan on continuing to do that. So come next Sunday night and give us your input. This coming Tuesday is the senior luncheon here at New Hope. If you've been before, you know the routine. If you're new, just show up. But it's a potluck lunch. There's always plenty to eat and lots of dessert. And usually we have a special speaker for you. Gene always plans some great special speakers. You do not have a very special speaker this week. You got me, all right? But I wanted to take an opportunity to speak with our seniors about something very, very practical. I'm going to talk about important issues at the end of life, things that you talk about with your family, plans that you can make, information you can leave behind. Just this past week, I helped a family, and it was not with an older person. This person was 49 years old who passed away. And if they had done some dialogue, if that family had been talked about some things, there would be less difficulty for them right now. There's some dysfunction in this set of circumstances, and that dysfunction is magnified now after a death considerably. And so I've tried to think of a good title to call this. I thought about calling it Tying Up Loose Ends. And then I thought for seniors, you might think that's a Maalox or something like that commercial, and it's not. Yeah. Yeah. But anyway, what we're calling it is Prepared to Die, Ready to Live, all right? And it really isn't only for seniors, but we are going to talk about some very, very practical things that I hope will be helpful. Operation Timothy is a discipleship program we have done around our church for years. Gene Sperling came on staff initially with that as one of the key thrusts, and he continues to oversee that. And he is going to launch a continental breakfast on August the 23rd. That's a Saturday morning, 8:15, over in the Murbach building. Operation Timothy is a one-on-one Bible study. One person is a Paul, one person is a Timothy, all right? One is a believer who is going to take a younger or less mature believer through a foundational study of the Scriptures. And it takes about a year, all right, to get that done. Meet him once a week, as frequently as you can, for an hour at a time. And if you have an interest in either being discipled, being the Timothy, being someone who is going to learn and grow from that, put your name on here, show up to the breakfast, and you'll get a lot of information at what this is all about. Or if you would like to take somebody through, you would love to share your faith in the context of the Operation Timothy materials, and you're saying, I think I would, but I don't know anything about the Operation Timothy, show up at this breakfast meeting. So it's for the discipler or the disciple, all right? Either one, if you want to find out more information, it's a free breakfast. Just sign up, let them know you're going to be there so they have plenty of food available for you. If you're a painter, please read the One Men's Ministries opportunity in the top right-hand corner of the announcements there. Talked about it last week. Please attend to that if you would. Let me highlight a few prayer requests. Families who have gone through death most recently and need our prayer for God's care and God's comfort in their lives. Joe Fish family, that service for Joe's mom is tomorrow at OLPH here in Clovis. The Kishin family, the Osborne family from our own church, Bernice, the Peabodys, the Scotts, and the Lockharts would appreciate your prayers. Wanda Wood from our 8 o'clock service did not get treatment started this week. There's a little confusion about insurance coverage. It is before the Physicians Board of Approval right now. I'm not saying anything else about that. Just pray for her. Frank Hicks is doing better. He's going to physical therapy, and he is improving. He called early this morning to pass on a few things, so please remember to pray for Frank. And then Frank Kirkman, who was in ICU 2 weeks ago, out of ICU last week, he is now home this week. Shirley Passarella, Chick's wife, was in the hospital this week with dehydration, so please be remembering to pray for Shirley as she continues to get stronger. And they found out their son in Virginia has a brain aneurysm, and so would you please be remembering to add that to your prayer list. So those are a few updates. Okay, I expect 10 men to have your name on that sign-up sheet, all right, to help the ladies plan their future events, all right? You bet. So there's a sign-up sheet underneath, ladies. Would you join with me as we pray? I'm going to ask our ushers to come forward and wait on us as we have our morning tithes and offering. My Father, I love you. I am grateful for your Son, the Lord Jesus. I'm grateful that the presence and the power of the Holy Spirit, that the Holy Spirit brings into our life, the life of your dear and precious Son. Jesus said, as my Father sent me, so send I you. And the Father sent the Son in the world, and the presence with the power of the Holy Spirit in him, and now the Son sends us with his own presence. And I thank you that for every need we have, Jesus provides the answer. And Father, that is available to us 24/7. My heart's desire is that someday I become as available to you as you, dear Lord, have made yourself available to me. And I trust that will be a desire of all of our hearts, that there wouldn't be a moment in a day or a decision in a day or a choice in a day that we don't think about what it is that you want to do and seek your wisdom and your leadership. Father, you know the needs of folks who've come today. You know some of the things they've carried with them from this past week. You know some of the challenges they've brought with them for events that are in their future. And Father, they may not have shared any of that with anybody. They've just come today hoping to hear from you. I trust that in the music and in the message and in the comfort of the fellowship of this congregation, but Father, we will let you have the freedom to speak, that our lips will be the lips that your voice speaks through. And our hands and arms will be the hands and arms that love is demonstrated to those who are in need today. Father, for those who've come because they're so excited about in their obedience how your blessings have been evident to them, then Father, may they lift their voice and their hands in adoration to you this day. For all of us, Father, who know that our very life is dependent upon you, we give our gifts to you today, not out of obligation, but, Father, out of a love that says, I will obey and I will trust. And I know that you are able to do more than what I can believe, hope, or ask. And so we offer to you our gifts today, saying thank you for how you use them for your kingdom's work. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Some of you came today, and you didn't get here on eagle's wings. Some of you probably came here today with barely enough energy to walk from your car to the pew. And so, Tim, I want to say thank you to you for letting God move in your heart to direct the music today. Because it was not just exaltation, it was ministry. So thank you very much. Even without a sermon today, some of you will walk back to your car with far more energy than you arrived here today. Not
not because of Tim, and not because of me, and not even because of all the instrumentalists, but because you allowed God and the message of music to speak to your heart. And so thank you. Thank you very much. Two other thank yous before I jump in the Word. One, thank you to Fawn for the Ladies' Day yesterday. Every woman, I think, just applauded. All right, that was good. My wife was gone 3 hours longer than I expected her to be gone yesterday. So she had a great time, and I had a nap. So it was really wonderful. Ladies, I think you should do this more often, actually. You know, gal's day out, that would be great. All right. So thank you, because thanks to the helpers, all right, because it was a great event. They had to move you to a bigger theater, all right, because so many of you showed up. That's great. And then thank you to Jennifer for having the idea to have a skate night, all right, on Tuesday night. And about 65, 70 of us were out at skate night. A few of us were much sorer the next morning than we were the day before. But we had a very, very good time together Tuesday evening as well. As you'll recall, we're wrapping up a series today we've been in for most of the summer months, 7 weeks. We've been looking at 40 Days to a Healthier You, taking part of this idea out of a book that was written by the Saddleback pastor down in Southern California. And as we look at a healthier you, we've not just been looking at the physical body, though that has been a part of it, but we have looked at the idea of making decisions today that are healthier for our tomorrows. We won't be healthier tomorrow if we don't make better decisions today. And so as we've looked at health over these past 6 to 7 weeks, we've looked at our physical health, and we've certainly looked at our spiritual health. We've looked at our mental and emotional health. We've looked at our financial health. And realizing that in all of those areas, and in none of those areas, will any of us ever get to what we might say is perfect health. I even realize as I talk about physical health, there are some who are here today, you have physical challenges that you will never get rid of. Some of you have diabetes, and even on a proper diet, you're still going to have diabetes. But I know you can make good decisions today that will make a difference tomorrow with your diabetes, all right? Gene often laughs when people bring lots of sweet stuffs here, and he says, "Why don't you just bring a gun and put it to my head," all right? So for us, we'd rather you bring a fine cigar, all right? That's healthier for us, all right? I'm planting the seed for Christmas time here, Gene. But we know that you may not be able, but even in whatever situation, there are some who are battling cancer, all right? We have folks in our congregation who've battled stage 4 cancer. We know what the outcome is going to be, but what are decisions I can make even as I go through that process that will enable me to be as healthy in every area as I possibly can while I'm going through this? Financially, what's financial health? Being a millionaire? Most of us will probably never make that, okay? Most of us probably will not. But that doesn't mean we can't be healthier financially next week, next month, because of decisions that we make today. And so in every area of our life, spiritually, we cannot be better equipped for the inconveniences of life in our future if we don't make better spiritual decisions today. And so that's what we've been looking at. We're wrapping that up. We hoped to do it last week, and I didn't finish, so we're going to finish it today. If you were here last week, most of you know that I kind of illustrated last Sunday's sermon with a deck of cards. All right, so let me just kind of catch us up on where I was. Let me see here. All right, we're good here. As you recall, I talked about how the fact that all of us are dealt life. It's kind of like, and I found out we got a lot of sinners in this church because I asked how many of you were familiar with poker, and almost every hand went up, all right? And even 5-card stud poker, in that game you're dealt 5 cards, that's it, all right? You get 5 cards. You don't get to trade them in, you don't get to do anything with them, you play the hand you're dealt. And with life, you and I are dealt a hand. And we talked about the 5 cards that we're dealt with in life last week. And those 5 cards were, first of all, my chemistry. All right, we looked at our chemistry. That's our DNA, our chromosomes. We had no choice about the hand we were dealt. I couldn't help the fact that my dad was a red-headed, freckle-faced kid. All right, I couldn't help the fact that my mother was hair as black as the darkest night, and that she was 1/8 Choctaw Indian. Okay? I didn't get to choose that. I'm happy, but I had nothing to do with that. I wanted to be 6'4". Okay? I didn't get to choose that DNA. I'm 5'8¼". Okay? I'm going to get every bit I can, all right? That's my DNA. I had no choice in that. I am what I am, all right? Then we were dealt a second card. Not only is it my chemistry, but it's my connections. My connections. And I had no choice in those early in my life that shaped me. My parents, my siblings, my cousins, my grandparents, my school teachers. I didn't have any choice in all that. My connections that significantly shaped my life early on, that was the card I was dealt. What state I was born in, what community I lived in, that was a card I was dealt. We looked at the third card, and that is our circumstances. Particularly early in our life, we don't control those circumstances. There are a lot of things. I remember getting beat up by a gang guy at school in the third grade. Okay, I didn't have any control over that. I thought it was a pretty likable guy. All right, but he didn't like my looks. Imagine that. And I took a couple of shots. Now what saved me in that one, and I really had nothing to do with that completely either. And that is that there happened to be the biggest kid in the school was a fourth grader, and he was a friend of mine. And he walked up about halfway through my beating, and so I only got beat half to death instead of all the way because of Rick Barry. But our circumstances, that's a card we're dealt. And then our consciousness, all right? The things inside our head. And again, early in our life, we didn't control that. We had nothing to do, as I shared with you, how blessed I was in my life to have the parents and the grandparents and the connections that my parents had that influenced my life and influenced my conscious thinking. But some people grow up in a family where they're told they're losers. They'll never amount to anything. They're no good. You'll end up in prison just like your daddy or just like your mama. You're going to be no good. You're going to fail. When you hear that enough, that's how you talk to yourself, and you feed on that. And we often, that's the hand that we are dealt. And then the last card, and that's a pretty good hand, isn't it? That's not a bad hand, huh? That's not a bad hand. And I'll be honest, I kind of think, I feel about my life like that could have been my hand. I've been blessed. And then there's one last card. It's the wild card. Okay? In this deck, it's a joker. If you don't have a joker in your deck and you want a wild card, what do you say? You ever played a game, Deuces Wild? Yeah. Or is that only on the machine at Chick Chansey? I just read about that machine is all. But you got a wild card, and this is the one that you have. This is the one I have the greatest amount of impact on, and this is my choices. My choices. I significantly now can impact this fifth card. And what we're going to discover today is how the choice we make with this card can significantly alter the influence of the hand that you have been dealt. I found out something I did not know this week. This happens when you read. When you read, you find out things you didn't know. So I recommend reading to you. I did not know that the term passing the buck was a poker term. How many of you knew that passing the buck was a poker? I got two professional gamblers in the congregation. Here's what it means. A buck was a marker that indicated whose turn it was to deal. And passing the buck moved the deal into the next player's hand. The dealer bears responsibility for the hands that are dealt, and nobody wants to deal. We would rather blame the dealer. So understanding that makes a lot more sense to me now why one of our former presidents, Harry Truman, if my memory is correct, said, "The buck stops here." In other words, I'm going to take responsibility for this choice. And folks, with this last card we've been dealt with in life, the buck stops here, there, there. So what we're going to look at today is the five winning choices that can improve the hand we've been dealt. The five winning choices. And each choice parallels with each one of these cards. My chemistry, my connections, my circumstances, and my consciousness. So let's jump in. We've got to get this finished today. First choice, the first choice I can make, and this is connected to my chemistry, is I can choose to get healthier. I don't care what handicap you think you have in life, you can be healthier than you are right now. You can make that choice. There are things that we can do that will increase our energy. There are things that we can do that will lower our stress. There are things that we can do that will cause us to have more power and more health in our life. We can eat better. Can most of you not agree we can probably eat better than we normally do? There are a few of you who are really health freaks and you are already there. You are already there. But I'm going to tell you, if we stop at fast food too many times in a week, all of us could say we can eat better. All right? When Shelly and I went on the 35 days that we were gluten-free, sugar-free, dairy-free, all right, we found fast food places that we could stop at where we could eat healthier. The Habit is one. Not a commercial. They're not paying me to do this. But they were more than happy to grill our patties and not give us any buns. And they would load veggies on it so that we could have a nice burger and vegetables and not have any of the other stuff. It takes more work, but we all can eat better. I found this ironic, but I discovered that when I was in college, in one of the classes, a health class that I took, they said, you know what? 40 years ago, you never found cancer in any of your pets. You never found cancer in your dogs and your cats. And you know the reason they explained? It's because the dogs and the cats ate the leftovers off of the table, and everything that people were eating on their table 40 years ago were homegrown. Eating better makes a difference in our lives. We can also get more sleep. How many of you would say you could use a little more sleep? All right, that question. How many of you think your spouse could use a little less sleep? Right, yeah. Yeah, all right. But most of you could use better quality of rest. And may I make one suggestion for improving your sleep? Turn it off, okay? Or at least turn it to silent, okay? I have a sister-in-law who has weird sleeping hours. She texts her sister at 2 in the morning, okay? And 3 in the morning because she's up. She also knows that her sister is deaf, okay? And Shelly takes her ears out at night. That's what we call it. She takes her ears out at night. So she doesn't hear the phone going off. Guess who does? Okay? But you do too. You can't tell me that I keep mine on, particularly when I'm on chaplain duty, because I need to hear the phone ring, all right? But if I know or I expect it could ring, I don't sleep near as well. When you got that on, so turn them off. Get better sleep. Reduce stress. There are things within our control that we can do. Stop bemoaning the fact that you don't have an Olympic body, that you're not a sprinter or a gymnast. The fact is, instead of bemoaning what we don't have, we need to do a better job of making the most of what we do have. We are stuck with the body that we've got, but we can improve the quality of health. The fact is, we're probably not taking the best care of ourselves. We're not making the most of what we've been given. Do you remember last week I had you read along with me Psalm 119:73? And here's what the psalmist wrote. You made my body, O Lord. Now give me sense to heed your laws. God, you've made this body, and you made it good. Help me to take good care of it. Help me to have the good sense to make good decisions. You see, improving the controllables, what I eat, how I exercise, how I rest, reduces the impact of the uncontrollables in my life. There are some things that you do not have control over, but if you take good care of the things that you do, you will be better equipped when the uncontrollables come along. You see, here's the deal, folks. I am never going to grow an inch taller. It just ain't going to happen. And let me tell you what else isn't going to happen. Y'all aren't going to have this body either. It's mine, and I'm not going to give it to you. There are things we can't change, but we can change the controllables. You can have more energy than you've got. You could be in a little better shape than you are. You could probably extend the quality of your life, if not the length of your life, by simply eating better, exercising appropriately, some things like that, so that it's in your control. For those of you who might be my age and older, all right, God, I can't believe I'm saying that. Maybe you need to go for a checkup. If it's been a while, go ask the doctor, what is appropriate exercise? My dad is 89 years old. There's appropriate exercise for him. Okay? There is appropriate exercise for every age. And it's not the remote control. That is not appropriate exercise. There are stuff that you can do so that you have more energy. Maybe you need to get some blood work done. Maybe you need to go to the dentist. Threw that in for my family. It's been 13 years since I've seen one. I'm shooting for 20. They're all fake in there anyway, so what good can they do with them? Maybe you need to get a supplement, all right, or some hormone replacement. I don't know. The fact is, there are some steps you can do, medicine, exercise, controllable things. Buy a copy of the Daniel Plan, a great book for covering all of these subjects on health, but particularly on the food and the exercise area. I would strongly encourage it. Some of you say, I'd like to work on my marriage, I'd like to work on my health, I'd like to work on my career, I'd like to be more mature in my faith, but you come home at night and I'm so tired. I just lie down on the couch and all I want to do is veg in front of the TV. Does that sound familiar to anybody? That's an energy issue. Start with the first physical card. What do I need to do physically so I can be healthier? Second choice. The second choice we can make that will change the hand we've been dealt or has to do with our connections. The choice I can make here is I can choose to deepen my relationships. I can choose to deepen my relationships. This is an intentional choice. Admit, my relationships are not perfect. I can choose to make them better. I can learn to communicate better. I can build some new healthy relationships, and I can replace some bad unhealthy relationships. Learn how to put boundaries on some of those relationships. I can risk connecting. I don't say that word risk arbitrarily or lightly, because any connection we make is going to be a risk. If you're going to build some new healthier relationships, there's going to be some risk in connecting. Write this down on your notes, okay? Those of you who write down, I'm going to give you something writable here. The fear of rejection prevents connection. The fear of rejection prevents connection. The reason why we feel disconnected is the fear of being rejected, of getting a feeling disapproval, of the fear of being hurt. Go back to the issue of marriage just for a minute. Many have been telling themselves, no one would ever want to marry me. With that attitude, you're probably right. And it starts with the way you think about yourself. It's not a, it's a feeling, not a fact. Me get married, remarried at my age? Talk to Marcy about that if you want some good sound advice on getting married at a late age in life. All right? It's never, ever too late. As long as you believe it, it probably will be true, but that's based on feelings, not facts. But the feelings come from the fear of rejection. Write this down. I'll give you another writable. Awkward won't kill you. Awkward won't kill you. It's awkward to develop new relationships. I've never met anybody who didn't feel a little awkward in developing a new friendship. Welcome to the human race. How do we get rid of fear? Well, 1 John chapter 4, verse 18 gives us some direction. It says, there is no fear in love. If you write in your Bible, circle, no fear. There is no fear in love. Perfect love casts out all fear. Do you want to know? Some people say, I'm not sure if I should marry this person. Do you know a new question I'm asking them? Is there anything you're afraid to talk to them about? Is there anything you're afraid to share with them? Because if there is, then maybe you're right. Maybe this isn't the right person for you to marry. Love and a husband and a wife should grow to where there's nothing that you can't talk about. Nothing you should be fearful of. Why does love take away fear? Because love takes the focus off of me and it puts my attention on someone else. It's not about me, my needs, my health, my heart, my hurt. Love has no fear because it's not about me. This is why we get uptight sometimes in social settings. You go to a party or you go to a church for the first time and you walk in and the first thing you're thinking is, how do I look to everybody? Do I have spinach in my teeth? Here's the deal, folks. When you're worried about what everybody else is thinking about you, let me share a secret. Most of the folks aren't thinking about you because they're wondering, what do you think about them? Self-centeredness walks in a room and says, how do I look to everybody? But love walks in a room, and I certainly hope it's true at church. Love walks in a room and says, who needs help? Who needs a word of encouragement? Who needs a pat on the back of affirmation? Who needs a hug to let them know that somebody cares? Love, humility, is not thinking less of yourself, saying, I'm no good, I'm nothing, I'm junk. No, humility is thinking of ourselves less. Humility isn't thinking of ourselves as no good. Humility is just not thinking about ourselves. We're so focused on the other person and meeting their needs. If I walked up here every Sunday morning and I worried about how I look to you, I would be scared to death. But if I come every day with the attitude, Lord, what is it that the folks who are here today need? If I'm thinking about your needs, your hurts, your interests, then I am not thinking about me. Perfect love casts out all fear. The antidote to social phobia is to get our eyes off of us, to stop being so self-centered, to think about somebody else and about their needs, their hurts, their interests, and how we can help them. Perfect love casts out all fear. I'm not an authority on anything, but I can tell you, I have dealt with fear my entire life. Fear. Best definition of fear I've ever heard is the acrostic, false evidence appearing real. False evidence appearing real. So how do we get rid of fear in our life? The fear of making that connection, the fear of making that commitment, the fear of getting to know a stranger, the fear of going to a small group. How do I get rid of that? We can't talk ourselves out of it because fear is not logical. It's not rational. So we can't rationalize all. We can rationalize all we want, but it won't go away. There's one way to get rid of fear. Do the thing that you fear the most. Move against your fear. Fear doesn't go away by logic. It goes away by action. You're the children of Israel. You walk up to the Red Sea. The Egyptian army is hot on your heels, ready to destroy you. There is this massive barrier called the Red Sea in front of you. And you pray, God, what do I do? And what does God tell him? Step into the sea. Face your fear. Take the action that I've given you. Walk right into the water. And what did the water do? It opened up. You see, I believe this with all of my heart. When God gives direction and we obey, action which is done in obedience to God will bring His blessings and His benefits. This is action done under His direction. Pray. The logical thing is not step into the water. But God said, you step, I'll divide. You step, I will make a way somehow. We move and fear vanishes. Fear is always, guys, remember this, fear is always worse than reality. Why? Because fear exaggerates everything and it extends everything. Fear torments us 24 hours a day. The reality is the party, the church service, only lasts about an hour and a half. The fear is always worse than the reality. The event, an hour and a half. The fear, all day long. So you have to say, what am I going to do? 1 Corinthians 14:1 says, let love be your highest goal. That ought to be your goal for the rest of your life. It is not about what can you accomplish or what can you achieve. It's not about how famous you become. It is about love. Let love be your highest goal. Life is all about learning how to love. You say, but Tim, I got burned bad in the past when I loved. I gave my heart on a platter. They took it, stomped it, tore it up, put it in a meat grinder, and made hamburger out of it. I'm never going to do that again. Think about John 3:16. For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whoever believes in Him would not perish but have everlasting life. And what has the vast majority of the world over the last 2,000 years done with that expression of love? They have stomped it and thrown it in a meat grinder and made hamburger out of it. And has God stopped loving? No. Do you think it's a good excuse to stop loving because you got hurt in the past? May I offer a prayer to you out of the New Testament? Ephesians chapter 3, verse 17 says, Paul writing, I pray that Christ will live in your hearts by faith and that your life will be strong in love and be built on love. Strong in and built in love. That ought to be our prayer every morning. By the way, where do we learn and improve our connection techniques? I believe the church was designed to be the laboratory of love. The Bible says they will know we are Christians by our love. Yeah. Well, we don't show a great deal of love in a Sunday morning worship service. I mean, we'll live a little bit, but we don't really connect here. So how can we really learn to love at New Hope Church? Small, you guys are getting so good. Small groups. Some of you are getting this, and some of you are getting so irritated at me for bringing this up again and again and again. But you see, here's what I know. I know that some of you don't get in a small group for the very reason of awkwardness. It feels so awkward to go to people's homes. I would feel so awkward if I had to ever invite somebody to my home, and you don't have to. There's no demand to come to your home in small groups. But what if there's some people in that group that I don't like? Great place to practice loving. Great place. Do you love ideal people? The people you love now, are they perfect? Are you perfect? In every group, there are going to be some people more challenging than others. Congratulations if you get somebody like that in your group. That's an opportunity to learn how to love. My small group has me. That's their challenge. The third, and I got to hurry. The third on the circumstances of life. The trauma, the trouble, the pain, the pressure, and the problems, the suffering of our life. This third card we were dealt. I can choose to trust God no matter what happens. This will give us an identity that very few people are going to have when we can trust God no matter what happens. When I go to the doctor and I hear the C word. When I answer the phone and I hear the D word. No matter what happens. Romans 8:28, we all know it. All things work together for good to those who love Him, called according to His purpose. Let me read it to you out of the Message, verses 27 and 29. God knows us far better than we know ourselves, right? So why don't we trust Him more than we trust ourselves? So why don't we trust Him in all situations? That's why we can be so sure that every detail in our lives of the love for God worked into something good. God knew what He was doing from the very beginning, and certainly you and I don't. He decided from the outset to shape the lives of those who love Him, and that's you and me, along the same lines as the life of His Son. God's goal is to make me and to make you in the image of His Son. The Son Jesus stands first in the line of humanity that was restored, and we see the original and intended shape of our lives in Him. You see, God wants to use every circumstance in your life and in my life to make me like Jesus. Psalm 34:1 says this, and this is part of the music that we sung about today. I will praise the Lord no matter what happens. No matter what, I will praise the Lord. When we get to that point, that's a choice. When we can say, I will praise the Lord no matter what, that is a confidence, folks, that no actor, actress in Hollywood has. That is a confidence no politician, including the one sitting in the White House, has. That is a confidence no professional on Wall Street has. It is the confidence that says, hit me with your best shot. I will praise the Lord no matter what. That's a confidence that's not built on money or sex appeal or status or passion or possessions or position. It is built on my relationship with God, and that can never be taken from me. When you have that kind of confidence, then you are an amazing woman, and you will be an amazing man. Write this down. Here's another writable. I am a product of my past, but I am not a prisoner of it. I'm a product, but not a prisoner. It has influenced me, my chemistry, my connections, my circumstances. I'm a product, but I'm not a prisoner. I can choose to be different. That leads me to number four. This is a big one. Fourth choice. I can choose what I think about. I can choose what I continue to allow in my mind. Our self is shaped by our memory of past events, and we talk to ourselves based on those past events. When you think a thought, a pattern, an electrical pattern is created in your brain. If somebody could remove the top of my head and watch me think a thought, if I think it again and again, it will go on that same trace in my brain. And when you think it 1,000 times, you've now created a rut in your brain. And some of you have thought the same negative junk in your life so often, you have got a grand canyon of doubt and depression in your mind. For years we were told, when you're an adult, you can't change your thinking. You're just stuck. That everything is shaped in your early childhood, and it's certainly finished by your adolescence. And then in 2002, a Nobel Prize was given to a Jewish doctor in neurobiology for proving that you can rewire the adult brain. Isn't it cool when science finally catches up with the Bible? Because God said 2,000 years ago in Romans 12, don't copy the behavior and the patterns of your old life, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. You see, humanity thought our brains were concrete, and what we've discovered is they're elastic. They can be changed. The shape can be remolded. Transform is the word in Greek, metamorphosis. It's what a cocoon goes through to become a butterfly. And God says in His Word, doesn't matter your age, let your brain be a cocoon and let it metamorphose into a butterfly. I heard Zig Ziglar say this quote probably 25 years ago at a seminar I went to, and it's been found in most of his books. And I think he goes along with Romans 12. Ziglar would say to folks, stop your stinking thinking. Stop your stinking thinking. Train your brain to think new thoughts. How do we do that? Philippians 4:8 says, dear brothers and sisters, let me say one more thing as I close this letter. Fix your thoughts. Fix your thoughts. That's intentional focus on what is true, honorable, and right. You will need to fill your mind with the truth so it can overcome the lies. If you grew up with parents who said you are a failure, read what God says about being His child. If you grew up with relatives who said, nobody loves you, read the scriptures in the Bible that says God loves you with all of His heart. If you grew up hearing people say you're going to be a failure and you'll never succeed, read the scriptures where God says, I've got plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Memorize new scripture. Remember, a Nobel Peace Prize was given that says old people can memorize. You can. You see, I think we took the science that we learned in the 20th century. You can't teach a old dog new tricks. You're not a dog. You are made in the image of God. And He said, I can renew your mind. Write them down. Put them in places where you can see them. Why don't you hang things in your home that remind you of the truths of who you are from the Scripture and tie those to pictures of key events in your life? Find a way so that whether you're walking down the hallway, going to bed in your bedroom, whether you're driving in your car, you've got something in front of you that reminds you of what God, your Heavenly Father, says about you. We can choose our consciousness. There is one more choice we can make. Last card. That's the wild card. The fifth choice is, I can choose Jesus as my Savior. This is the one card. This is the one choice that can make even a better hand than this. And it can take your really lousy hand and it can make it into a winning hand. And when I'm talking about this, I'm not talking solely about the choice of saving you out of hell and into heaven. I'm not just talking about your sins forgiven. You ought to do that. If you haven't done that, settle that one. Settle it right now. Invite Christ in your life at this very moment. But I'm talking to most of us in here who've already done that. And I'm asking you to let Jesus be your Savior every day. The Savior of your health. The Savior of your finances. The Savior of your relationships. The one who can overcome the hand you have been dealt in your life. This changes everything. I get the power to follow through on these choices when I surrender my life to Christ, because then I do not accomplish things in my life by willpower, which is why a diet only lasts about 10 days. Why my daily devotional reading might last a month instead of a year, because we try to accomplish those things by willpower rather than by God's power. You and I need to say something like this: Jesus, I need you to save me from my chemistry. I need you to save me and rescue me from my connections and my circumstances. God, I need you to help me talk to myself better. Jesus, I need you. I need you to make me a brand new person every single day. And the Bible says, old things pass away, all things become new. God says to us, I'm waiting for you to use the wild card that I've given you. The wild card is I created you in my image. And my image is you have the freedom to choose me and transformation or yourself. And you'll have to play the cards you're dealt. If you and I choose wisely and we choose Christ, He takes the worst of hands and He takes the best of hands and He transformed them into the hand I've always wanted. I'm missing one. Here we go. Can you all see that hand? What is that called? That is a royal flush. And do you know how, you know what's required to have a royal flush in life? It's when the King of Kings sits on the throne of your heart every day. Then whatever hand in life you've been dealt will be trumped by the hand you now have. Is the King of Kings sitting on the throne of your heart? Has He ever sat there? If not, invite Him in today. If you invited Him in the past, but you let Him sit there sometimes, but not all the time, why don't you make the choice today that says, from now on, every morning, I'm going to trust it to Him. He'll make a difference in a healthier you in every area of your life. Let's pray. Our Father, thanks for this time we've had these last 6 or 7 weeks. Thank you for challenging us to be healthier, not just physically, but Father, in every walk of our life, but knowing that this body is the temple of the living God ought to challenge us, encourage us, motivate us to take the best care of this body we can so that you get the best out of us that you possibly could desire. Father, this has been a good foundation for where we're starting next week to look at those key 30 truths out of your word that we should build our life on. If somebody asks us, do we know what we believe? Could we tell them one thing, two things, three things, five things, 10 things? I trust, Father, in a year from now, if somebody asks this congregation what they believe, any one of them could say, let me tell you, how long do you have? I can tell you 30 things that make a difference in my life. Father, for that man or that woman who's here today and they're inviting you into their life for the very first time, thank you that you hear their prayer. And for that man or woman who came here today beaten down, struggling with life, and somehow you've encouraged them today, I trust that you will respond quickly to their prayer to let you be Lord today and change the hand they've been dealt. You're big enough for the task. Thank you for giving us the privilege to be part of your process. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.